official theme song for our new book event, The Vinyl Cafe, and we're playing them all so you can help choose the winner. We posted all 7 that we're playing here today on the show on our website. So if you want to hear these again, you can find us on the web at vinylcafe.com. You can listen online and then write to us via the website. There's a contact us page there. And send us a message, vote for your favorite. Just tell us the name of the song you think should be the official theme song to our new book, Revenge the Vinyl Cafe. Entries need to be in by November the 1st. You got, 2 weeks or something? And we'll announce the winning song in December. You can head over to vinylcafe.com for more information about the music, to listen to the songs or read the lyrics, and to vote for your favorite. Okay, here comes one of my favorites. I got a short list. I haven't decided my favorite yet, but I got a short list for 2 or 3. And this one is a song called Attack of the Treadmill. But before we get to it, I'm going to play you the story that inspired this song. So first the story, then the song. Here's the story. The story's called Attack of the Treadmill. This story began the Saturday morning Dave's shoelace broke. Began like this. Dave and Morley were on their way to the market. The idea was to go early and get back before Sam woke up. The idea was fresh blueberry pancakes for breakfast. They were running late, of course. Morley at least 3 steps ahead of Dave. And he could feel her frustration beginning to simmer. He was hurrying to catch up. He was trying to make it to the door before the simmer became a boil. He thought he was ready, but of course he wasn't close to ready. He had to run upstairs for his wallet, then after he'd done that, he couldn't find the car keys anywhere. He looked at Morley and grinned painfully, said, I'm sure I left them here. He was pointing to the basket by the back door. Of course, he hadn't left them in the basket by the back door. Anyone could see that. And if you knew him, you could tell by the way he said, I'm sure I left them here. But he wasn't sure at all. But he didn't have a clue where he left them. The keys, it turned out, were upstairs in the laundry basket. In the pocket of jeans he was wearing on Thursday, which is the last time he drove the car. That took about 5 more minutes to work out. Morley waiting by the door through all this, through the discovery that they were missing and the searching and the working out, waiting still when he came down the stairs for the 3rd time with the keys in his triumphant little hand. I have no idea what they were doing there, he said, genuinely mystified. And then he stepped into his sneakers and he sat on the stairs to do them up. Go on, he said, as if she hadn't been waiting since this began. I'll be right out, he said. And that's when he pulled the laces tight, and that's when the left lace snapped. And that is the exact moment this story began. That moment by the back door when Dave's shoelace broke, and Dave said, just a minute, and he ran to the basement, and he grabbed the very first thing that he saw down there that had laces, which happened to be a pair of skates. And he ripped the long wax lace out of one of the skates, and he stuffed it in his pocket, and he tripped out to the car, one shoe half on and half off. When they got to the market, Dave headed for the little cafe by the entrance, the one on the right with the sandwiches. I'll catch up, he said. And he sat there, and he threaded the hockey lace into his sneaker. When he was finished, there was a lot of lace left over. So he did a double knot and he stuffed the leftover lace into the shoe and he was good to go. Sam was awake when they got home, but it was Saturday and he was watching television, not even close to feeding himself. So technically they made it in time and they had pancakes for lunch and no harm was done. 2 weeks went by. It was a Friday, twilight. That sweet moment of indifference between day and night. Dave and Morley and Sam, sitting in the back seat, were in the sweetest place you could be for that great, gray, cosmic sky. They were on the road, in between here and there, trying to decide where they were going to pull off the highway for the night. I don't care, said Sam, as long as it has a pool. They were said, can we take a picture? The totem motor is indoor pool. Big holding. Before long, Wally was settling him on the riotous lounge on their David stands were heading for the pool. There was already a kid in the water. He was older than Sam, but he was acting a lot younger. He was loud and splashing. He was obnoxious. Mama Day walked into the room. The kid got out of the water and ran across the pool deck and jumped back into the water right in front of Dave. Cannonball. Hey, said Dave, jumping back. Too late. He was already soaked. Kid ruined their swim. And Sam took off. Dave lingered behind and waited for Sam to get out of earshot. And as soon as he walked over to the kid, leaned over and said, you know what? That you were old enough to know better. Next morning, Dave woke up first. He lay in bed for a while, but Morley wasn't stirring. After a few minutes, he propped himself up on an elbow and whispered in his sleeping wife's ear. He said, I'm going to go have a walkabout. I'll bring you a coffee. Morley mumbled, don't hurry. And she rolled over and went back to sleep. Dave pulled on the pants and t-shirt he was wearing the night before and padded to the door. He hung the Do Not Disturb sign on the handle, and he closed it softly behind him. He took the stairs down rather than the elevator. When he got to the lobby, he saw a girl behind the desk wearing a brown tunic. Morning, she said, cheery Saturday smile. She pointed down the hall, complimentary coffee in the Crockett room. Dave set off past the elevator and the rack of the brochures, past the dark bar where he and Morley had had a beer by the fireplace the night before, past the pool, and there was the Crockett room, a right turn after the fitness center. He had to use his room key to open the fitness center door. He went in backwards, pushing the door with his hip, coffee in one hand and a surprisingly delicious cinnamon bun in the other. The room was bigger than you would have expected, small nonetheless, a couple of Nautilus machines, a rowing machine, and one of those, whatever you call them, running machines. There was an LED control panel with a daunting number of choices, age, weight, aerobic, anaerobic, fitness level. What did that mean? They make these things unnecessarily complicated, thought Dave. They should just have on and off. Dave took a sip of his coffee and stared at the screen. Personalized program. Now that was promising. He reached out and pressed personalized program. And a voice said, good morning, Brandon. And then the belt he was standing on lurched and what was left of his coffee flew out of his hand and splashed onto the control panel. And then the voice, which Dave now realized was coming out of the machine, was saying, in 10, it was saying in 9, 8, 7. Little too much was happening at once. And it was all happening a little too quickly. The treadmill was speeding up and making Dave walk a little faster. The machine is balanced at the last time. Heavy said Dave in the central line, hopping along the treadmill on his right foot now, pulling with the left, but his left foot won't come, and it's not because someone grabbed it. It's because both ends of that overlong hockey lace were disappearing into the bowels of the machine. Dave's shoelace was wrapping itself around the treadmill rollers, and he couldn't pull it loose. He was trapped. And then the voice from the machine was saying, in 3, 2, 1, and there was a flourish of trumpets. Maybe it was the theme from Rocky. And the treadmill began to rise up in the air. Dave was running uphill now, hopping, actually. His heart pounding, his leg pumping, his mind racing. Just who was this Brandon? And why on earth would he choose to do this to himself? And then Dave felt a wave of hope. There was a stop button. It was right in front of him, as plain as day. He smiled, and he reached out, and he pressed it, and nothing happened.